mashallah, I think everyone knows you, alhamdulillah. But you know, so basically Sheikh Yahya, he's a very inspiring role model. We look up to him, our forces. And so his journey started by memorizing the Quran in his teens. He's continued his studies in Egypt. Then he's been traveling the world, enriching thousands and thousands of lives. You know, he's got initiatives in Australia as well, which include diversity training, cultural sensitivity programs, educational lectures, alhamdulillah. And although Sheikh Yahya is known for his, you know, spiritually uplifting discussions and addressing topics of Sunnah and tradition, he's very passionate, mashallah, also presenting on social topics, including domestic violence, misogyny, gender discrimination, child protection. I could go on and on. Respectful relationships, disability, mental health, the list goes on. Mashallah. So yeah, that's pretty much the intro, and I don't think my brother Imad is here, so you can take it away, inshallah, and he can recite at the end.
Allah do that, agree. We'll give a little bit of Quran in our presentation as well, inshallah.
Okay.
Allah very Hassan. Jazakallah khair. All right. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidil Mursaleen, Sayyidina wa Nabiyina wa Habibina Muhammad. عليه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك على سيدنا وحبيبنا ونبينا محمد في الأولين وصل وسلم وزد وبارك على سيدنا ونبينا محمد في الآخرين اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك على سيدنا ونبينا محمد في الملأ الأعلى يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم علمنا ما جهلنا من القرآن العظيم وذكرنا منه ما نسينا اللهم بارك لنا فيما رزقتنا وقنا عذاب النار ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما ربنا عليك توكلنا وإليك أنبنا وإليك المصير ربنا لا تجعلنا فتنة للقوم الظالمين ونجنا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين. It's a pleasure and an honor that I have an opportunity to connect with all of you across the different parts of the world, alhamdulillah. It is one of the great blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we find ourselves in different lockdown situations due to this COVID scourge that has been a part and parcel of life with us for the last year. We pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lifts from us its plague, removes from us its harm, and grants us, inshallah, the reward of being of those who are able, inshallah, to live through it and be examples of righteousness and good to others. Allahumma ameen. It is sadly one of those moments that is bittersweet, where alhamdulillah we can connect with each other virtually, but at times those who we love, who live in our city, who are our best friends, we can't just get in the car and drive across and be with them and you know, just experience that physical connection that we normally do. And I wanted, alhamdulillah, to acknowledge all of those who have come together, both on the Zoom and through the FOSIS channel. Jazakumullah khair to the student unions across the United Kingdom for all of the perseverance and the hard work and the charity that you put forward all throughout last year. I read so much about some of the incredible impact that you guys have had, both in your local spheres and across your country and internationally. And it is incredibly inspiring. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen those who are holding positions of service or leadership, I guess, but really it is service of the Muslim community and the broader community at the various universities. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make them able to bring about in their place, in their stead, when they move on, those who will carry on the mantle and fight forward the good battle of seeking good and justice and righteousness for all. Allahumma ameen. So the topic that was chosen for me by a young sister named Layla, Jazahullah Khair. And she said, you know, we'd like, you know, she kind of framed it in a very nice email where she said that there is a significant amount of burnout at times. And sometimes we kind of lose track of the bigger picture of why we do the things we do, why we put in so much effort, so much hard work for the service of others and for leading others. And the discussion that was asked for me to carry with for the next 30 minutes, inshallah, so we can open space for Q&A, is to speak about to know our why, to know why we do the things we do. And I wanted to begin, you know, speaking in a very plain way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has set for us an important principle in life. And this is something that as Muslims, we come to discover through our faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the generations that came before us were those who were ordered also by Allah to come to learn this very same principle of life. And that is that the more you become acquainted with who you are and what you love and what is important to you, the more able you are to be able to provide and to assist and to serve others into the future. And we have this colloquial saying in the Arabic language in Egypt, for example, where we say, فَاقَدُ شَيْءِ لَا يُعْطِي, the one who has nothing can give nothing. And the one who knows nothing can teach nothing. And the one who has no possessions is not one who can deliver to others their needs. And I think that's a really important mindset. The Prophet ﷺ frames it in a much more eloquent way. He says, الْيَدُ الْعُلْيَا خَيْرٌ مِنَ الْيَدِ السُّفْلَى. The hand that is above, the hand that's giving, is much better than the hand that is receiving. It's much better than the hand that is outstretched to receive something in return. And for you and I, it becomes really important to kind of think about the strength that we seek to establish in life, the clarity that we seek to establish, and what it is that we want for our future selves. And I speak directly to those of you, alhamdulillah, who are still waging that educational battle at university across the United Kingdom and attached through your different ISOCs and MSAs in different parts of the world, that this is a time of sprouting of the seeds. You know, your seed is there, but now you're irrigating and now your shoots are beginning to spread and you're going to, inshallah, begin to bloom into the world. So we want to channel that energy and to understand it. One of the key aspects of my life and your life is to put into mind, put into practice, that yes, your aim is to become self-sufficient. And yet your aim is to become a giver, not a taker, a provider, not one who is dependent. You want to become the one who gives, not the one who receives. You want to be the one who is offering, not the one who is asking. You want to be the one who is beneficent to others, not the one who is the recipient. And that is a very powerful framework that we as Muslims have always had and have always been trained to have. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in the Quran, and the Prophet ﷺ mentions it in different ways through his tradition. So I want to begin, inshallah, after having given that introduction. Your aim and my aim is personal salvation and personal strength, personal affluence, personal influence, personal social commitment and status. We want to exemplify the best version and the best person that we can put forward for our own benefit first, but for everyone in our circle of influence and circle of and the sphere of our influence, inshallah. So let's talk about that question and let's talk about that statement. What do you know of yourself and why do we do the things we do? Knowing your why becomes a very powerful motivating factor. What is it that causes you to fulfill the acts of worship that you do? And what is it that causes you to get up and do the things you do? So I'd like to share with you something that I actually shared with my students here in Perth in my Friday khutbah. So I'm a high school teacher. I'm an assistant principal. And I function at universities as a chaplain at University of Western Australia and Curtin University. So I'm in charge of a school as an assistant principal that caters from kindy all the way to year 12 and then matriculation into university. So I kind of meet young people all throughout their different stages. And the topic that I had for my high school boys who were seated in front of me, I asked them, what makes the lion king of the jungle? And I want you to think about that. You know, why is the lion known as king of the jungle? He's not the biggest. He's not the fastest. He's not the most ferocious. He's not the best teamwork member. What is it that makes the lion the one who dominates every other species in the jungle? You know, the elephant is bigger, but when it steps forward and sees a lion in its presence, it steps back. Although it's larger in size, the elephant looks to the lion as being the king and it being subordinate, being unable to meet that challenge, to face off against the lion. The lion is outpaced by the cheetah. It's quicker, it's more agile, it's more stealthy. The lion is not as clever as, you know, chimpanzees and monkeys and some of the other animals that roam the jungle. But what makes the lion the lion is that he knows why he is the lion. He knows why I'm king of the jungle. When he steps forward, he has no doubt, he has full confidence in himself that I rule this land and everything in it is mine. I am there to fulfill this will, to do what it is that I seek in it. And that sense of confidence, that knowledge of why, of what, of how, and of who, that you can almost see within that persona of a lion is something that is very powerful. In the Arabic culture, lions were always seen as something that was regal, right? They were always kings, they were always observed. And in Arabic culture, when something is, you know, important and it has been given, you know, a high place in its culture, they would give it often many different kind of names. So some of the names of my viewers at the moment is all in reference, both male names and female names, to names that describe lions in their different stages of youth and maturity. So you get Hamza, right? The word Hamza, you know, the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ, he was an Asadullah. He was referred to as like the lion of God. But the word Hamza actually means lion. The word Asad, of course, means lion. Layth, lion. Sufyan, lion, right? All of the Hafs and Hafsa, all of those words, they are different labels. Shibl, they all mean the same thing, lion. And that kind of shows you that mindset, you know. It was something that was awe-inspiring to the Arabic people, to the Sahaba of the Prophet ﷺ, and they would give their names of the personality traits that they want. So what makes Lion King of the Jungle? It's not his size, it's not his speed, it's not his intelligence, it's not his cooperation and teamwork, it's his mindset, is that he knows why. He knows what he wants and why he wants it, and he makes a determined effort to attain it. In common pedagogical studies, you know, when you study education, you will see that they will talk about growth mindsets and allowing people to kind of think about some of the things that they go through to attain the successes that they want at the end. And this is something that's really powerful. There was an experiment that was done in the late 50s, early 60s. It's referred to as the marshmallow test, and you can go and Google it and read about it later to get a bigger picture to it. But I'm just gonna summarize it quickly because this kind of shows the importance of endurance, self-determination, and knowing why I want something. So they would bring young children, 4 years old, 5 years old, they'll sit them down at a desk, there's a camera filming, they don't know it's filming them, and they're without their parents, and they said, listen, sit here, we have this treat, this lolly, this marshmallow that we want you to, that belongs to you. We're giving you this. This is yours. And they put it on the desk just a little bit out of their reach. And they say, but listen, before you reach out and eat it, this is a little bit before lunch. All the kids are hungry. They do this multiple times. We want you just to know that if you can wait until I go to my office and come back, I'll give you another one. So you'll have two. I'm going to double your marshmallows. It's up to you though. And the examiner leaves the room and there's this kid, the camera's beaming. And you know, some of the kids, they instinctively, before the guy even walks out the door, before the sentence is finished, impulsively, they've gobbled it up. It's eaten, it's gone. And that's it, that's the end of it. For others, they are a little bit duplicitous. They'll take a bite of it, they'll lick it, they'll sniff it, they'll, you know, and they'll alter it, of course, they'll have little bits of it, half of it is gone. And then they put it back. They fought, but they just couldn't get there. And the third type of category, about 10 to percent of young children naturally have this innate power that's been taught to them by parents who are like them, who were able to restrain their impulse for achieving what they wanted in that moment and to defer gratification, to defer themselves until the second one arrived, and then they could have two. And they waited, and sometimes they pushed to see how long these kids would wait. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, an hour. Some kids just sat there and they would do things to kind of help themselves. They'd rock or they'd push it to another side of the desk or they turn their body completely away from it and so on. Why is that important? Because they tracked these kids over the next 30, 40, 50 years of their life. And they found that those who were very impulsive, most of the time they trended to be those who didn't finish their schools, didn't keep a good job, they bounce from one relationship to another, and they were the most prone likely to end in divorce. Now, I know all of you are gonna rush home and give your little kids a marshmallow or your little brothers and sisters and say, let me see what you're gonna do, right? I'm gonna predict your future. Now, of course, there is bias, because if you were born in a family that was poor and the first thing that was put on the table, everybody's hand reached for it, you've been trained to just take it while you can. Now, of course, if you account for that bias, the standard is still accurate. You know, the mindset becomes really important. Now, those young children on the other spectrum who were able to restrain themselves, they kept their job, they were happily married, but more importantly, they were able to pass on those traits and that discipline to their children. That's powerful. The thing that was most engaging about this whole research was that when they asked the children why, they said, because if I waited, I could get more. So they understood on a cognitive level, on a conscious level, that I can get something for being patient. And if you look closely at all of the five pillars of our faith, the four actionable pillars, leaving off ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, you look at the four pillars of Islam, all of them seek to teach us that mindset of deferred gratification. So you stand up and you say, Allahu Akbar, Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, nobody's going to pay you anything. Nobody's going to slip $5 into your wallet, £5 into your wallet and say, well done, that was a great Maghrib, mashallah, you read, mashallah, that was great. Here's $10, brother. Nobody's going to give you anything. The gratification of it, the understanding of it is that you're seeking something in a deferred state. And you wake up and you're tired and you're doing all of that, but you believe that there is something that will see you through into the next stage. And that becomes very powerful. The month of Ramadan, subhanAllah, 59, 58 days away for us. The whole concept of Ramadan is Shahrul Sabr. One of the names the ulama give it is that it's the month of patience. It's the month of endurance. It's the month where innama yuwaffa as-sabiruna ajrahum bighayri hisab. Those who are patient will get a reward that's limitless, and that reward is the same reward as the one fasting. The same wording is used in both instances, so the ulama make that connection that the two are synonymous with each other, right? That becomes really powerful. The third act of giving zakah is a very powerful thing. Giving zakah is something that's, you're deferring, you're giving from your real material wealth now for the hope that it will be returned, adha'af and mudha'afa, returned to you many times over in this life, or it could be into the next life. But you know that you've given it out into the void, which is the qadr and the reception of Allah, that its qadr will return to you many, many fold over in a more positive way in your life. Hajj, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala return us to the sacred land, is a mission of sabr. It's a mission of going and enduring and pushing forward to discover why I'm there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنَّهَا مِن تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. It is entirely an act of sincerity from the heart that allows you to give magnificence and to esteem the sacred rites of the Hajj and that which Allah has appointed for us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to have that mindset where to know our why for each and every action becomes troublesome. but to know our why in terms of our purpose in life becomes the greatest aim that you and I have. And this is where I'm going to taper off my discussion, inshallah, in the next 5 minutes or so to open the doors for questions that, you know, within the next few minutes. I do want it to be something where we go back and forth with discussion, inshallah. So if you have your questions, put them through in the chat service, inshallah, in the Zoom service, or in the way our brother Hassan and sister Layla will recommend for you, inshallah. And those of you following on my Facebook page, you can put it forward, inshallah. I'll try to track through them, bi-ithnillah. But I wanted to end with this final message, the concept of a growth mindset. So we spoke about, you know, be the king of your own jungle. Each of us, we have our own jungle, right? Be your own Mufasa, right? Be your own lion. Number two, marshmallows are sweet, but they're sweeter when they're doubled up, right? They're sweeter when they're doubled up. And think of your ibadah with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as not just doubled or tripled, but much more through. The third is this concept of a growth mindset, which is a really revolutionary kind of concept in Western education, but it's been a standard within our Islamic tradition. This concept of going back and fixing and what is called hyper-correction and allowing yourself to know that although I made a mistake, that mistake is actually just a stepping stone to success. So, when I first went out for my driver's test, I was 16, this is back home in Toronto in Canada. And I can clearly see it. You know, I can picture in my mind right now, there was this female driving instructor and I was like 16 years old. I got my permit, my letters. And 6 months later, I was allowed to sit for the test. Back then at 16 on the day, you could write and you can do your driver's test within the next day or two. And I had taken 2 or 3 driving lessons with someone, but I was driving with my dad and this and that. And I thought I was hot stuff, mashallah. And I got in the seat, buckled up. I did everything right, except one thing. When I would signal, like I still remember what I did wrong, right? It was so impactful in my life. When I signaled, I actually signaled and turned while I was like signaling and turning rather than signaled, waited for the 2 clicks, flash, flash, and then turned. So it's like I had already committed to the turn and then signaled, which is, to me, was a minor mistake. I was like ready to go, man. I was ready to pass that test. And the lady, she said, you drove very well, Yahya. And she got my name right. But I'm going to have to fail you. And when I heard those 3 words, I'm going to have to fail you, I said, you don't have to do anything. Like in my mind, you know, nobody's forcing you. Nobody's got a gun to your head. You don't got to do nothing. You can pass me if you want to pass me. You want to fail me. And then she said something that was profound. She said, but you will never make that mistake again. And she told me what my mistake was and the reason that I failed, because it is something that they do look for. You have to look over your shoulder, signal, look over your shoulder, look again, a double, you know, look in your mirror and then go. And I never forgot it, obviously never forgot it, because it's hyper correction, right? It's something that was corrected in a way that would that you would never lose sight of that again. And I went back the second time, passed the test, and you know, I've been driving ever since. But she said something profound then. She said, this is just part of you passing. You gotta look at this as part of you passing. Don't look at it as you failed and it's over, but this is just like a dry run of you passing your next test. And that's growth mindset, that in your mind, you believe that every hurdle, every stumble, every illness, every rejection, every missed opportunity that you thought was your opportunity, the thing you wanted, the thing that is going to make, you know, everything, my dreams come true. Every step along the way, each and every one of those is just making you prepared and preparing you for that which is actually yours. And you and I as Muslims, we have this way of looking at the world where we understand that everything that is provided for us is provided for us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the water that I've drawn into this cup, bismillah, you know, the sip that I've just taken there, that's mine. Like that's my rizq. there's no way that that water, even if you lived in my own home, it's not my wife's rizq who's just a few meters away from me. It's not my children's rizq who's in their bedrooms now getting ready to sleep. It's not theirs, it's mine. That sip of water traveled for millennia to be mine. And that's how we look at it. That's why you say Bismillah. You know, as I said, Bismillah, as you drink it, you understand this is destined for me from Allah. Nobody else could have that sip of water but me. And that water 500 million years ago, it could have been an iceberg in the Antarctic. 100 million years ago, it could have been melted into salt water. 20 million years ago, it could have rained down in Indonesia. And over the last 10 years, it's been trickling in underwater freshwater aquifers to be bottled in Australia or piped in Australia into my tap, that when I turned my tap, these drops of water were what entered my cup, not my neighbor's cup, because it's my rizq. Nobody can contest it. Nobody can take from you what is written from you for you. And nobody can give you what isn't yours. And that's the growth mindset that was inspirational and delivered to us by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he says, احفظ الله يحفظ, guard Allah, guard the rights of Allah upon you, your worship of Allah, he will guard you, and be careful with how you approach your understanding of fate. For if the whole world gathered to give you what wasn't destined for you, they can't provide it. And if the whole world came together to take from you what was written for you, no one can strip it away from you. And the pens have dried and the scrolls have been rolled, right? So understand that each and every aspect of your life, each and every step in your life's purpose, has a reason, has something that can lead you towards greater things. Have that growth mindset and let it influence your why. Why has this happened to me? Because this is something that's allowing me to get to the place that I seek to be. This is just another step along the path to the greatness that I will assume and receive in this life and in the next. And I hope that that's something that has come clear in this discussion. So there were three essential elements that I wanted to share with you today. Be the king of your own jungle. See yourself as king. See yourself as the one who is there to master their domain, be a person who's in control and in charge of their life, who is ready and willing and able to put forward an honest effort, is not scared off and is not timid by the challenges that lay ahead, and is willing and able to serve those who are within their vicinity. Number two, recognize that the sweet things in life are not always those at hand, and that your desire and the things that you want immediately are not necessarily the things that are best for you in life. It's not going to be that in terms of your consumption, in terms of your relationships, in terms of what your heart fawns for, and our eyes met across the room, and all that, there was fireworks in the background. It just happened to be the 4th of July, and that kind of thing. That's not usually what is best. That there's a temperament that is necessary for myself and you to appreciate and to assume. And number three is, whenever you stumble, get up, dust yourself off, and move forward, step after step, day after day, week after week, month after month. Continue to push forward and improve in your relationship and in your commitment with Allah, with your family, with your friends, with your community, and set upon that precedent where you are a person who is functional in the best and the capacities that you can be. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to use you as a conduit of good in the service of others, that you become a person who opens the door for others as much so as you seek for others to open it for you, that you're a cornerstone for foundations to be built atop of your contribution, that you're the one who is willing to put their knee for people to stand up and get to a higher rim and to a higher place than they could have reached on their own, that you are remembered not for who you were, but for what you left behind and did for others, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you the honor of being one who is able to serve others in life. Allahumma ameen. So this is where I'm going to bring my contribution or that, you know, I guess the primer to a discussion. I'll give you a few minutes, inshallah, to get your questions in. And I'll just look through my own links here on Facebook. And if there aren't any that are coming through the chat service with you guys, I'm happy to share some of the ones that have come through my social media, inshallah. So let me hand it over to my brother Hassan once again.
Jazakallah khair, ya Sheikh. That was honestly amazing and super, super beneficial. And, you know, there was just before we move on to the Q&A, I just want to say that there was one point that really stuck with me. That was, you know, the rizq that we're going to get it's written for us. So we shouldn't worry too much about the little things in life. We should, you know, be happy with what we have and, you know, accept that it's our rizq. And it reminded me, just before we move on, it reminded me of dua that we read after salah, you know, Allahumma la mani lima atait wa la mu'ti lima manaht wa la yanfa'u dhul jadd minkal jadd. You know, no one can hold back what you give and no one can give what you hold back, and no one's wealth can help them against you, ya Allah. And that really stuck with me, so jazakallah khair for that. So we're going to move on to the Q&A, and I'm going to pass it over to Sister Layla, inshallah, and read out the questions. So guys, get your questions through, inshallah. Jazakallah khair.
MashaAllah, tabarakallah.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh Yahya. Again, thank you so much for sharing this beautiful reminder. May Allah reward you. I'm just going to share a few questions that some of the sisters have shared. So we have a sister from Indonesia, mashallah. She said, Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. How do you overcome the anxiety about future, although we have determined the purpose of life? Sometimes our iman is unstable.
All right. How do we overcome the anxiety of worrying about our future? So there are three points, I think, that become really important. First, have an understanding of what Muslims believe about qadar. What is our creed and what do we believe about fate? And once you begin understanding how fate works, so for example, let me just summarize it in these two minutes, inshallah. There are three important aspects in how fate reacts to you. Two of them are beyond your control. The first of them are things that happen to you that you cannot prevent. It's not because you did anything wrong or you committed a crime, so Allah's punishing you. No, it is just intended that this was going to befall you. And even before you were brought into this world, this challenge was going to be given to you that Allah knows in His divine wisdom is going to result in something down the road in your life or into the next that is better for you than with them. The second are things that are happening within you. And the things that happen within you are, you know, as I'm standing in front of you and as you're sitting there at home, wherever you are, there are things that are happening within your body, health issues. There are things, you know, that are there that are not in our control and you cannot prevent them. It's genetic, dispositions. All of these are different things that are there. The third aspect is how you react to the first two things that happen to me externally from me and things that happen from within me. How do I react and do I show rida, contentment, in whatever life throws at me that I know is determined by Allah's authority? So am I able to be worshiping and thankful of Allah when things go well in my life that I acknowledge it's Allah that's the source and I say, Masha Allah, this is only by the will of Allah that allowed me to attain what I attain? And am I able to say, Alhamdulillah, I'm still remain thankful, praising to Allah when things don't go the way I want them? And in both instances, it shows a completion of our belief in qadar. So that's the first step. Learn more about qadar. Take an opportunity to study a classical understanding and a contemporary practice of what it means to believe in fate. Number two is don't focus on the pixel. rather look at the big picture. So in your phone or your tablet that you're watching me on, or your TV screen or whatever it is, it's made up of millions of pixels. If you look at one place in it, it's like a black dot. It's a dark section of that area. And if you were to just zoom into that place, you would assume the whole thing is just dark. But if you pan out of it, if you zoom out of that collection and cluster of a dark spot, of a dark day, of a bad moment, of a terrible experience, if you zoom out to the tapestry and the beauty of the totality of your life that has been lived in its positive moments and what yet is coming, you will see that there is so much greatness and so much facility that has not yet arrived. It gives you optimism and hope. Number three is look towards those who are in a struggle in life and not just those who have it made as so you would think, which you're wrong in thinking. Don't look to those who you aspire to be only, but understand that there are those who are aspiring to be in your situation, and to know that you are from the privilege in life. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give all of us a contentment of heart, a rida of our purpose, and allow us to understand our belief in Qadr in a way that is meaningful in this life and the next. Allahumma ameen.
Ameen. Jazakallah khairan, Shaykh. Once again, I hope, sister, that you are pleased with the answer. We have another question from another sister. She's asking, how can we thrive in our faith on a day-to-day basis and live or work in the West?
All right. How can we thrive in our faith on a day-to-day basis, irrespective of where you live, West or not West? It doesn't matter. So there are another three simple rules just for the brevity of time. First, it's about the small things, not the big things. It's about doing the regular small habits consistently each and every day, each and every week, each and every month, rather than doing the one-off big deeds, right? It is far better for you as a believer to be regular in a Quran circle where you're reading just, a page for a week or something, than to try to read all of Juz in one day and do that once in Ramadan, right? You see a lot of people, they put in effort in certain periods of time and then they fall back in others. The Prophet ﷺ says, it is more beloved to Allah that you do good deeds, even if they're minuscule, but consistently over an extended period of time.